Attention all warriors. Are you tired of the mundane? Looking for a new and exciting challenge? The Irish Peacekeeping Ninja Force is seeking new recruits to join our ranks. If you're a highly skilled retired individual with a full clean EU driver's license, then we're the organization for you. As a member of our elite force, you'll be trained in the art of stealth and combat, ready to face any threat that comes your way. If you have a passion for justice, then the Irish Peacekeeping Ninja Force has a role for you. Take on the challenge and become part of something bigger than yourself. Apply now to join our ranks. Together, we will work to create a world free of snakes and rats.
He is Duncan MacLeod, the Highlander. Born in 1592 in the Highlands of Scotland, and he is still alive. He is immortal. For 400 years, he's been a warrior, a lover, a wanderer, constantly facing other immortals in combat to the death. The winner takes his enemy's head, and with it, his power. In the end, there can be only one. May it be Duncan MacLeod, the Highlander.
From the dawn of time, we came, moving silently down through the centuries, living many secret lives, struggling to reach the time of the Best Bits podcast, when the few who remain will battle to the last. No one has ever known we were among you until now.
That was it.
This is the Best Bits commentary podcast, and this week we will be doing Highlander.
Oh my God.
I'm Jamie Hannigan, and this is my co-host, Kevin.
Hello.
This is my other co-host, Will.
Hi, Jamie.
Yes, we're doing another episode of All the Best Bits, and this is going to be our last episode of All the Best Bits for the foreseeable future.
Yeah, we're going to park the concept for a little bit and do something exciting and new.
Yes.
In the future.
That's Jamie, what's your schedule looking like? Lads, I've seen this film once. I know it's one of your favourite films, Will, but what is it for you, Jamie?
It's also a big favourite, but for weird reasons. I don't understand. I have a memory of putting this on at my college film club. They were like putting on, we're going to put on movies. And they were putting a lot of arty stuff on. And they asked me to do it.
So pretentious.
I was like, I'm going to take Highlander. And then yes. I remember just like the silence after, like it played, it came out. And I was like,
you were at the wrong film school. I would have buddied up with you immediately because I'm like, oh yeah, somebody who's into the same superficial shit as myself. I love it.
So did you lose all your friends as a consequence, Jamie, or did what was the reaction?
I remember one friend, Paul O'Farrell, just coming over, and he'd taken the week before, he'd selected Betty Blue as the movie. This is movie. He just sort of came over and was shaking his head. It's like, yeah, it wasn't really as good as I remembered.
Oh lordy, lordy. Oh my God.
So I have a very different take on this film because I only watched this film, it was either last year or the year before.
Wow. Mm.
That was my very first introduction to it. And I was bamboozled and baffled by the film.
Yeah.
So I'm ready to re-experience the absolute madness, which is Highlander.
Oh, wow. Shall we hit play, guys?
We may as well. What else are we going
to
do?
Might as well. I'm ready to go.
Jamie, do you want to count the stone?
Yeah.
Okay. 3, 2, 1, play.
Just felt so relaxed. I just wanted to do it. It went
nice. And we're off.
Studio we're Canal, off. Is it? I don't know who actually is there. Guys, you were talking about when you first experienced this, and I experienced this through my neighbour, who introduced
Julie
me.
Julie Cremin.
Shirley Cremin. Very Shirley close, Cremin. Very close. And she said, I've got the best film ever. And she was right. It is one of the greatest films ever made. So I became...
And as you say that, the Canon logo comes up, which disputes your...
I didn't know Canon were behind it, because it has been now, it's been a minute since I've seen this film. But you were talking about screening at Jamie at a film festival. Here we go. This is the, we have the opening crawl.
Somebody
here.
Read that out.
Jamie, will you read that?
From the dawn of time we came, moving silently through the centuries, living many secret lives, struggling to reach the time of the gathering, when the few who remain will battle to the last. No one has ever known we were among you until now. I just read recently that Connery recorded this. It's a really weird echo because Connery recorded it in his Spanish villa, and the producers either just didn't care or they were too scared of him to tell him there was a massive echo.
Yeah. Because you know where he recorded it? In his bathroom.
There you go.
Did he?
Yeah. He recorded it in his bathroom. That's where he recorded.
And you know where he was sitting?
Yeah.
In his bathroom?
Yeah.
There's only one seat in the bathroom.
Through the dawn! Time.
I think the reverb kind of suits it.
I keep forgetting John. I worked with John Plato in a short movie.
Michael Kamen.
He's the cop in
really?
This. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. He's very good in it. He's very good in it. But I want to. I have a similar story to you when you screened it at that film school, right? But in my
it case, wasn't a film school, I should say. It was just a college. I didn't go to film school.
Oh, it was college. Okay. Oh, sorry. At college. But when I was, I was introduced to this
culinary school
when I was about eight, and I
wondered they were all confused
from about eight until from about eight. I thought this was the best film ever made, and at around 12. I had met some other friends who'd never seen it, and I went, I've got to show you the best film that's ever made, because we were comparing. Anyway, they watched it and they were equally as dumbfounded as your college mates. We went, really? So we open a Madison Square Garden, right? And it's a wrestling match, and there is a fucking,
look at them,
class shot coming up, and I still don't know how they did it. I'd love for both of your opinion on how they pulled off the shot.
The first time I saw this, there was a video shop on the... I was probably about 8 years. Never at eight. I don't know, something like that. It was a video shop in the Captain's Hill in Leixlip. You know the way in video shops they'd play videos in the corner.
Yeah.
You know, on the TV to entice people in. And I was in staying with my cousin Anne. This is on one of those sports things, isn't it? The volley things.
Did they have them back then?
Invented by guy or
Your friend,
Gareth Brown. Yeah, he invented those.
Did he? He invented them as well?
Gareth Brown invented every sort of camera rig device that's been used in any sporting event ever. He's done them all bespoke.
Wow. Yeah. That is a great shot, though.
Yeah, it's a great shot.
It's like the opening of Psycho.
It's a cracker of a shot.
Well, as a kid, this is the thing I saw, this moment. I was in the video shop, just like, look, staying at my cousin, like, looking to rent RoboCop, and... this was on in the corner, and I was watching it going, oh, is it a wrestling match? And then I was like, as you'll now see when they cut to medieval Scotland, I was like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah.
Man, he's a...
That's what I love about this film, is that time jumping. It feels like almost like a time travel film, because it does jump back to, you know, Scotland, different time periods and stuff like that.
Yeah,
and I like the editing of this film. This film is well edited.
Yeah, no, it is.
How did Christopher Lambert get this role? He's a very unusual choice.
He got it,
Tarzan
from Tarzan. Yeah, yeah, and he had very little English. Very, very little English.
Was he dubbed in Tarzan like Andy McDowell?
No, he wasn't dubbed, but he didn't have that much English. He didn't have.
I mean,
that
he was
many,
playing an
ape
man,
lines,
Kevin. So you know,
there you go.
He get away.
Couldn't speak English.
I can. This is the Grey Stokes one, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. Grey Stokes. Yeah, which I kind of have.
Robert Town.
Have a soft spot for that. Mm. Was it? And it might have
sure
been.
He would write anything if you paid him enough.
Wouldn't we all, Kevin?
Here we go.
That's true, actually.
Underground car park. You know, as a teenager, and I had to wear long trench coats just for this reason, just so I could hide a sword under it. And I didn't have a sword, but yeah. I thought, like, what if people thought I had a sword? That's almost as good.
Puberty is rough.
But lads, I don't think anyone can deny that this film isn't well shot. no matter what you say about the story, I think it looks classy all the time. Like, it, there's a lot of long lenses. There's a lot of ambitious, ambitious settings and
crushing coke cans underfoot.
Yeah.
There's a moment coming up here where I had to stop the film and I thought, like, what is going on? And it's the fight that ends with the guy doing cartwheels all the way out of the parking garage.
Yeah.
When it would be faster just to walk away.
Okay.
It would have been.
All right.
Now he's being challenged. Like, wait. No, guy's not waiting. He's just going to pull out a sword and start fucking around. The fact that this guy is, as you say, he just does look... I mean, he's dressed like a middle-aged businessman, and he moves when they're not using the stunt double like a middle-aged businessman.
Awesome. That's so true. It is so true.
So, I'm going to go off memory, though.
Okay.
This guy has shown up to challenge him to be the Highlander.
No,
not the, he is the Highlander. The idea is, the mythology is, these are immortals. They are just born, and they are competing against each other to be. They're drawn to each other to be the one, and they have to behead each other. Once there's one left, they absorb all
so
the
it's
power
a bit like
of every.
And Power Rangers, then.
I don't know. I didn't grow up.
It's
in the
been
power
a while
Ranger
since
era.
I saw Power Rangers. Yeah. I don't remember
my
decapitation.
Time. Or after my time.
A bit before, it was a bit after my
after
time as
my
well,
time.
But you know, I'm just trying to denigrate the film here.
I read the guy who wrote this, whose name has just dropped out of my head, Gregory Widen.
Yeah.
That was it. And he wrote this in film school. He was like still just like, I think just barely out of his teens. And he'd been watching the Duelists and had this idea of like these guys, like the same sort of thing, but the guys doing it throughout history. I like it.
Another great shot.
Yeah. Like rain. It's not rain, it's a sprinkler system, but like.
Yeah.
There's the sound effects of the swords clanging is particularly.
It's.
Individual to this film.
Individual. Yeah. I used to think they were amazing when I was eight. Maybe now I might change that. I actually did see an interview with the writer. And he said he got the idea when he was in film school, as you said, in England. He's American, but he was in England.
Oh, here's there he is. Flip, sorry. Kevin. There's the backflip.
There's the backflip.
No, this is the first time he's going to...
Oh, he does another
gonna,
one. Yeah.
Yeah.
It does look...
It's not just another one. He just keeps going the entire length of the parking garage.
I forgot he does two. And back, if, oh, there he is again.
There we
back
go.
Backflips.
There we go.
It's so,
I think there's two kinds of films in the world.
Why?
There's a film where if a guy has the choice... He backflips out of a garage.
No, he's standing there.
A choice
where
he doesn't. Like, all films should have someone backflipping out of a scene, frankly.
Yes.
All films.
Yes.
Think of a film.
You would have loved the Power Rangers, Jamie.
Think of a film that wouldn't be improved by having someone backflipping out of a scene. Stalker.
That's what? To be. It was the thing that Driving Miss Daisy was missing, Jamie.
Schindler's List.
Absolutely.
Barry Lyndon. Yeah. Barry Lyndon would have been like. Immeasurably improved by having several scenes of Barry Lyndon just like backflipping out of scene. Like,
if Citizen Kane had a backflip, I really think he would have, his career wouldn't have gone to shit. I think that would have saved him.
Or Rosebud.
Yeah.
I'm embarrassed to say the little flippy thing he does with the sword when he sort of is facing it, flips it around. I spent hours practicing how to do that. Oh, there's his head cut off.
Oh, here we go.
Savage. See, this is probably the moment where it won over every boy.
Yeah.
It was like, oh, he beheaded him.
Yeah.
You don't see that in your average episode of He-Man.
So this is what's happening.
Yeah, this is what's happening.
He's absorbing all of his memories, all of his power. But it really is
going into the car.
It's called the quickening, McLeod.
There we go. Oh. There we go.
And I think they told the actors, like, you got to really look like this is an orgasm. Like, you've got to look like you're, like, Christopher Lambert is looking like a big spotlight. They put a big red on him there, turned it on full, and it's like, wind machine on.
My retinas.
Lambert is like, oh, yeah.
Do you know he could barely see? That he actually has that. What's that eye condition?
You're joking me. Yeah. It doesn't look that way at all when you look at him squinting all the time.
Well, he's got a... What's the eye condition? Is it...
Myopia.
Myopia, there you go, yeah. You can barely see.
There's a documentary about the making of Highlander 2, which I'll get into, I suppose, as we go in later on.
Right.
And, yeah, he was like, it's very difficult to do precision sword fights when you're, like, short-sighted and you're carrying quite heavy... They're not rapiers. They're, like, you know, they're large. And then his katanas, broadswords. Like, anyway, he cut off, like, part of Michael Ironside's finger, I think, in a duel in Highlander 2.
Really? But,
that's how he hides his sword. He's just, like...
He won't look up there.
What is it? What is it? Like an overhead, like a vent or something?
I think it might be a kind of a vent, yeah. John McClane might drop out of it soon.
And then suddenly...
There we go. Look at that transition. Look at that transition. Oh, that was beautiful. Really was.
Cinema for real.
That was planned. And hey, the score...
And they built that castle.
The score and fucking Queen soundtrack. Oh, Michael Kamen and a Queen. Just wonderful.
The soundtrack is like almost impossible to get a hold of. It's to download, to buy. There's versions released and then not released. May this year have alert 15.
Is that because of Queen?
I don't know. They never released it as an album, which was really odd. But they did release some of the tracks in a following up album. Maybe that's a part of the reason that it's
a kind of magic. Yeah. Apparently, I heard they weren't the first band who were offered the part.
Really? Who was before?
I'll have to look up
ABBA.
Wikipedia. Like, check it out.
No, it's okay.
It was a band I had not heard of. Hold on a second. Maybe that.
The Beatles.
Lame.
Beatles?
They came back together just to do the soundtrack for Highlander, the canon movie. Yep. What's the name of the guys?
This is for John.
What's the name of the producers, the canon producers?
British rock band Marillion turned down the chance to record the soundtrack because they were on a world tour. A missed opportunity, which guitarist Steve Rothery later said he regretted. Apparently the
band were called the Marillion.
Marillion. It's in Marillion. This is this actress here who's like, you know, going, come back to me soon, Connor. What is she, what's her? Celia Embry? Yeah. Is that her name?
What else was she?
She's a very... She's one of the...
I'll find her.
Pillars of British stage.
The Best Marigold Hotel is one of the last things I think I've seen her in.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Now, this clan in Scotland, they're going to go fight against the... What are they? The McGregors? I can't remember. We'll say the subtitles here. Oh, nice lightning there.
Here we go, lads.
It's your first battle. It's Clancy Brown.
Talk about, there's some good costume design. You know, who's the baddie? That's the fucking baddie right there. The guy with this goat's skull on his head.
The 6'2" guy with the skull on his head. I love, what's this guy like patting his horse down? He's rubbing his horse.
Yeah.
Who's going to rub? Who wants that job? It's like, listen, Bob, you've got the job of rubbing the horse of this, like, the 6'5" Russian guy with the weird skull helmet who just, like, kills people for random reasons. It's like, oh, fuck that.
It's either that or...
I'd quit.
But,
oh, man, that's a great landscape. Look at that sign, that landscape. Amazing. Yeah. So good.
The casting, then. Do you like... Who's cast in the roles?
Oh God, yeah. Oh yeah. Well, the primary roles. I love Chris Lambert and Connery, even though it's completely ridiculous. And Clancy Brown is fantastic. So yeah, so far, absolutely. What about you?
Me or James?
either one of you. Forgot there's two of us here.
What do you think, Kev? You're not a fan. It's a weird choice casting a Frenchman. Yeah, it's a medieval Scotland.
I don't think he's very convincing in this.
You see, I grew up with him.
Yes, exactly. So you grew up with him. So to you, he's basically your dad.
He's Highlander.
But to me, he's like, he's just a miscast actor. And
I love the priest.
Cutting the guy's throat. He was.
I'd
heard he was cast.
Murder somebody and then bless yourself.
Your man, like the Russell Mulcahy said, what was it that he just had this really foreign element that he thought like worked for someone who's just a man out of time. Like he just had a something, which I guess kind of works. Like he's a Scottish guy talking with a very.
I agree with you, Jamie. When he's in the contemporary New York scenes, he feels like a foreigner, and he said that, and that's how it felt to me as a kid, and I think I always feel that. And someone who's seen a lot of shit in his time, he just has that mysterious look at him. Like, there's a difference between him being here versus in the New York stuff. You know, he's quite naive here. And silly.
But so is the Kurgan. He's like he's just like very straightforward. Like I'm just like murdering people in a straightforward way. And then he turns a bit nuts by the time. I'd read that Gregory Widen, in his first draft, that the Kurgan was actually a knight who was driven kind of mad by his. Has the picture gone a bit odd there?
Yeah,
the picture quality just completely
it's
changed.
Not this isn't iris out. So it's an.
Right.
Yeah, it was an optical thing. They were coming out of his eye.
Well, you really do know this movie like the back of your hand.
I remember.
Anyway, the Kurgan was like that's a great shot in the back of the car as it zooms through.
It's class.
Is that Christopher Lambert? Because I would be terrified in the back of that car if he was bombing it in the parking garage, not able to see 2 feet in front of him.
You know, watching this again, I'm kind of like, so does he just cut a guy's head off in the car park, and then he drives out of the car park. I mean, and suddenly there's like every single policeman in New York is there. It's like who found the
question
body?
It. That's all I would say. I mean, the scale, the spectacle, the tone of it is great, but the continuity and the way that the story unfolds, it takes big leaps.
Oh, it certainly does. Like, if you start to scrutinize it at all, you kind of have to use Christopher Lambert vision when analyzing the plot, where you're just squinting at it and you go, oh, yeah, kind of looks like it works together. Yeah, it's okay. But if you really look at it with 2020 vision, there's a great transition coming up again. I love these. I love them. Just moving across and just love.
I'm going to ask ignorant questions. And who directed this?
Russell Mulcahy.
So, Russell Mulcahy was an Australian.
He was a music video director before this.
That's what I was going to say, because I didn't know whether it was that guy was the music video director or the guy that directed the second one was a music
He directed
director.
The second one as well.
Did not enjoy
Russell
the experience.
Directed the second one as well?
Yeah.
He did both of them, okay. Russell Mulcahy, he was a very... He directed a lot of music videos in the early MTV era. He was like a hot shot, probably like a David Fincher before David Fincher. And I think this film looks great. You can't deny it. It looks absolutely fantastic. But he did The Shadow, he did a couple of one or two Resident Evil movies after it. And he kind of disappeared after Highlander 2. His career didn't really... It took a dip.
He's Australian, isn't he?
Yeah.
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 He did it.
Jon Snow here.
Was it his first movie? Was a quite cool carnivorous giant pig movie called Razorback.
Razorback.
Yeah. Yeah. Razorback.
Yeah.
I wanted to take a stab at it, but all I could think of was Rawhead Rex, so I thought I would just...
No, it's got a really good sense of kind of Mad Maxy sense of place to it. I like it. Considering it's a gigantic pig, it takes exactly the right kind of tongue in cheekness with it. Anyway, so here we are in Madison Square Gardens with the crime scene where literally every single person is there. I love this police. Yeah. Who's this character actor?
Unusual lens choices.
What's this guy's name? The police sergeant here. That actor is.
Oh, I'm trying to recall him.
There's John.
So many faces.
Do you know him?
I worked with him years ago on a short movie, but he's better known for all his Coen Brothers stuff. Like John did like in Miller's Crossing and like A lot of Coen Brothers stuff.
Is it John Cassidy? Is it
John Polito?
John Polito.
Yeah. Very nice chap. He passed away a few years ago.
Oh God.
This is very early, I think, on his career.
I was actually just trying to look him up. Oh God, I loved it. There's just little details in this I always enjoyed, like him spelling coffee on himself and stuff like that. Now, the evidence mounts up against Mr. Nash pretty quickly here. You know, they found he's an antiques dealer. That's what he does in his day job. They have found a decapitated body of some wealthy foreigner with an antique sword underneath the ground. They have him fleeing the scene. And I think he gets off pretty light, to be honest with you.
Well, if you find a sword at a scene beside a decapitated body, you're going to assume like that's the sword that was used on him. And probably, yes. I guess that they don't reckon that it was a sword fight. Because, you know, they're 20th century cops.
I suppose, that was the murder weapon. There you go. There's a blind stare.
It's called a hard stare.
Yeah. In his case, in Chris's case, he's looking across going, is that a person or a coat rack?
Is that my eyeline? Maybe that's my eyeline.
He was Polish.
Oh no, this is another body. Cool. This is because all the immortals are flocking to New York for reasons.
Yeah.
And so this Polish guy got killed in the mythology. In Jersey. Then this guy's got killed in Madison Square Gardens.
Yeah, the Connery will set it up later on. He said, in the future, we're all going to be summoned to a new land. This is before America's discovered. And there we'll fight until there's only one of us left. So
were the wrestlers at the beginning, were they also Highlanders?
Yeah. I assume so.
Okay.
I'm hearing now, sorry.
That makes sense why you'd start it there. Look at him. He's so smug.
Yeah.
For a man that can't see. Okay, I need to stop now. I do enjoy this film. Ooh, that's a dodgy line there.
Oh, yeah, yeah. For a piece of ass. Yeah.
No, the line they followed it up with. They used the F slur.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The guy throws the words horse punch.
Reminds me of school.
By the time you get to Highlander 3, this beat cop has been promoted to a detective, I think.
I've only seen Highlander 3 once. And
I didn't even know they made a Highlander 3. Oh. I remember there was a Highlander TV show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
With like a big dude with long, dark hair.
Yeah. Yeah. I maybe saw a couple of episodes and hoped it to be good, but it just, even to 13, 14-year-old me, it didn't stick.
It had its moments.
Did you watch much of it, Jamie?
I watched a little bit. But I thought your man was quite, did a better, the Canadian guy who was the lead, was a more convincing Scottish accent than Christopher Lambert. And he had a sort of better, what's his name? What's his name again? Adrian something? Anyway, he kind of had a, I don't know, he looked a bit like Sean Connery, which is kind of odd, but I don't suppose that really... Just like confusing things. Also, there's a Highlander animated TV show. There's a Highlander manga TV show. There's been a
Victor Kruger.
Here's the Kurgan in the present day,
with his throat slit, healed over.
Yeah, man. Like you know, they say there's a kind of an old cliche, screenwriting cliche, that your film is only as good as
your bad guy. Get the money up front.
Get the money up front, that's true too. But just, I love all the little ancillary characters in this as well. Don't talk to the guests. That's great stuff. But I think the Kurgan is a fucking class villain. I really think he's ominous and kind of terrifying.
Yeah, Clancy Brown is great.
Yeah. And I love his sniper case that he's got his big, huge fuck-off sword in.
He does a lot of voiceover work, though.
Yeah. He's done a lot of DC stuff. He's been Lex Luthor for a long, long time in all on the DC things.
I remember when I saw the Shawshank Redemption, and I was like, shit, that's the Kurgan. Was the guard. What's the guard's name?
Oh, I can't remember his name.
He was the one to push him off the roof.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't imagine a sword that you could like assemble like that. I mean, very good for like, you know, I guess traveling. But I don't know.
It would fall apart.
Well, I suppose would it stand up in battle?
Yeah, it doesn't seem like it would pass the quality test. Here we go. I'm Candy. He's like when he says,
Of course you are. And of course, I guess his line readings after, spoiler, after he gets his throat cut open by Sean Connery halfway through the movie, he's like all coarse now.
Yeah, it is class.
Yeah. And this is the CSI Highlander. This is basically a chemistry room.
Yeah. I'm not surprised he didn't wipe that little fragment on his trousers before he handed it over to her, just like contaminate as much as possible. I just got some gum on it here, darling, you know.
Interesting choice of angles.
That's all over the place. Do you mean interesting in a good way or
interesting in a good way, yeah.
Yeah,
I'm watching this and I've totally given up on the fact that the story is written by a teenager for other teenagers.
Yeah.
But the lenses, the staging, the way the camera's moving, they're all deliberate choices, and they're really interesting choices. Mm-hmm. It's stylish. Yeah.
It is.
I'll say this for Highlander 2. Highlander 3, I guess, is the real sequel. But Highlander 2 is just, which is bonkers. They rebooted to the fact that they're all aliens.
That is one of those films that you said there was a documentary out there, and I haven't found it.
I'll send you the link to it. I watched about 45 minutes of it, and it's quite interesting.
It's not EPK stuff. It's kind of like made in retrospect. Where they're open? Are they open about what actually happened?
I haven't seen it all, but it's so far they seem to be quite open about the fact that, like, yeah, we were really. I mean, at the moment where I'm watching it, is that they're still in the middle of filming it.
Okay.
And they're just, you know, Argentina was having financial problems. Between that and the fact that they were unused to the Argentinian way of basically having like 3-hour lunches and like a couple of bottles of wine.
Wow.
The production designer was like, yeah, we're getting like scaffolding to do these builds. And like, they were just getting, you know, random rusty scaffolding from like wherever they could, like up building sites and stuff from other countries. And it's like, I've never been as close to death as I have been on that shoot. It's interesting, but it was like, yeah, they didn't. It was like, well, we sort of wrote ourselves out of a sequel.
Yeah. Yeah.
Madison Square Garden. Do you go there often?
Why?
Basketball? The circus? Wrestling?
Why are you asking me about the garden? Have you been following me?
I'd like to walk you home, Brenda.
Look at that, though. They decided to put massive halo lights outside the bar to give that sort of arc light through the pub, and it's lovely.
Isn't that it? This is a film that looks nice from every scene. It really does look lovely.
What was the budget of this film?
Well, it's Canon, so I'd say about $6.
No, Canon were chucking tons of money into their movies.
I bet you.
19 million, according to Wikipedia.
Oh, well, that's decent.
But they were some. I think this is a studio. Canon may have been there, but there was some bigger studio behind this. No? In the documentary, they end up that the producers are basically giving out how in the U.S. they did this like weird. It's like they had this poster. It's close, black and white close up of Christopher Lambert's face that made him look like a serial rapist, and it was like that was the poster. And in Europe, he said they went all out. They did they like in France, they did like it was a big deal. Like it was only when they went abroad that the film became sort of got the reputation as being like, oh, this is actually something. Listen. Oh, here's Clancy Brown.
Yes. Sorry. Yes.
McLeod. Never quite got how he was like always like looking for the Highlander. Like he always knew from the start that Jesus, Clancy Brown just like towers over Christopher Lambert here, isn't he?
Mm-hmm. What height is Clancy Brown?
Must be over. He's like 6 foot, at least 6 foot two or three or something. Right? Someone looked it up.
Every time I ask a question, Will's face lights up because
you're checking it out on Wikipedia.
Shut up.
The screen lights up on his face because he's going onto Google because I'm asking him questions.
Yeah, because I'm looking. I know. So, I don't know how tall he is, but I
appreciate that. I appreciate you doing that. It's funny to me, and I don't know why I mentioned it. This does look like a music video director, though. Directed this.
Yeah, he was. This is his bread and butter. It really is. So much smoke. You could just. Oh, in actual fact, Steam. In actual fact, they did the music video. They shot them. He obviously directed the music video, for the Queen track. And Christopher Lambert is in it, and they actually restaged, some of the fights with Freddie Mercury and Christopher Lambert. Freddie Mercury's using his microphone stand as his sword, and they used the set for the big fight at the end up in that. Anyway, when we get to it, I'll point it out. But yeah, it's worth looking up.
Did the police officer and the chopper just shout out through a megaphone, "Come back here"?
jump on.
He's like Chief Wiggum in the Simpsons episode.
Stop running away.
It's like, no, come back. Continue bathing naked.
Also, they're throwing a ton of resources into pursuing him.
There we go. A lovely transition back in time. So the dude.
Oh, that was good. That was clever.
The dude who wrote it, what was his name again? The
Widen, teenager.
Greg somebody.
Widen.
Yeah. He was, so as you said, he was a student. And how
Gregory
when,
Widen.
Widen.
Oh. Okay.
It's like widening, but without the thing on the end.
I thought you said Gregory Widen.
He got the idea when he was studying in the UK. He went down to the Tower of London and was looking at the display of all these armory display cases of like armor and swords and weapons. And he just went, wow, wouldn't it be cool to own all this? And he said, wow, wouldn't it be cool to have used all this? And like, what if you were alive for all the years that would have been required to actually have worn these in battle? And that's where the idea came from. And the script was written by the end of the weekend. So there you go. But he said as well, he actually
it went through a lot of drafts, I bet.
Oh yeah, there's other writers involved. He wanted to do a time travel film, but not have it feel like a time travel film. But like, obviously, our character doesn't go in a machine, but it's just the way it's structured.
It's just longevity. He lives long enough.
Yes, that's it. And I think that's fun. I think that's one of the appeals of this film. We see him in different periods.
It is strange that like, basically, like they think, you know, Connor McLeod gets wounded in battle and then like he looks really sick and they think he's going to die and then he recovers and they're just like, oh, he's dead. I like this stuff, they got him in stocks here, they like chase him out of town. Classic Scottish goodbye.
Has been talk of a Highlander remake for years now, but is there any movement in it?
Oh, it's what's his dick? Superman. Henry Cavill he's signed on to play Connor McLeod. No, it's Chad Stelsky, the John Wick guy. stunt coordinator in The Matrix. Can't remember. Oh, I can't pronounce okay. it. It's Jalen. You know what I'm talking about.
Actually, anyway. Wasn't that just recently announced?
Yes. I believe you actually texted it to me.
I probably did.
I haven't watched, but I want to try the Witcher series. I haven't watched any of it. There's a nice transition for the Mona Lisa.
I've heard the second season's a vast improvement on the first.
Oh, okay.
It's too late. They lost me with the first season. There's too much stuff for me to go back.
Look at this. Oh, it's down the south side of the city anyway, that's for sure.
Sets were bigger back then, weren't they?
Imagine what that would cost, you know. Like would you call this a studio loft? Is that
almost like a one bedroom in Dublin?
Yeah, quite possibly. Yeah.
Is that a matte painting at the back there? Like your?
I bet you it is, Jamie.
Yeah, it would have to be.
Yeah. Good call. We're definitely doing.
Obviously,
that back
when
to
they
the
say the meatpacking district, they mean. That it was a lot of meat
that's what
was getting packed there. It was like factory.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
It's not like a red light district or anything.
No.
No.
I mean, maybe also, I don't know. I love this. He's got his big, I'm gonna go into my eight-sided brooding room. Brood.
A conversation pit, that's what those are called. And they were all over the place in the 60s. And I loved them and I wish they came back. I'd love a conversation pit. Yeah.
Here, guys, if you looked at that last shot of the castle, that was a complete matte painting on top of the, let's say, a tower ruined base, but the top of it was a matte painting. That was kind of class, though.
I mean, look how beautiful Scotland looks.
Yeah.
I mean, on camera, I wouldn't like to be there.
Oh, imagine living back. Imagine living back then. In Scotland, with your top off.
I'd say you would just be half frozen. Mud.
I love his line readings here. I blossom just the way you like it. Sticks his head in a buttload.
It's a really convincing like Edinburgh type accent. Look at that. That's a very convincing kiss as well.
Yeah.
It's a very, like, you've always, last we saw him, people were throwing literal pieces of shit at him while he was, like, strapped to a piece of wood. And suddenly he's got a castle in the middle of nowhere. He's got a lovely lady. He's probably got some kind of, like, job. And just as they're kissing, oh no, it's Sean fucking Connery.
Yeah. In a flash of light, it's like he, what's the word? He's Dr. Strange then.
I want Sean Villalobos Ramirez. King Charles. With the Spain. And I met your subs.
Another great costume. Like peacock feathers. I love it.
What do you want?
I still am trying to figure out, right, this is one of these things now I actually have to study. Why, if Sean Connery is one of the immortals...
Yeah.
Why is he coming to train another immortal when he should be just decapitating him?
I have the feeling there was some kind of like larger.
Don't
like,
they explain it in the second one?
Of cut it was not explained. The second one just like confuses everything. I think there was something about the Highlanders. Is like remember the TV series when it was more. It was like he was supposed to be this. Chosen one. It was like, but all this prophecy stuff. Maybe if that was in the movie, it was cut out.
Who are you? Okay.
We are the Shame MacLeod. We are brothers.
They're just jump cutting all over the place.
Yeah, it's great. I love it.
Put his hands up, and suddenly he teleported to another location on the hill.
And here we are back. And you know what I enjoy about this as well is the grime, is these grimy New York locations. That this crummy Hill Street Blues environment, and everyone looks pissed off.
It looks great on camera, but I wouldn't like to be there.
Oh, I'd hate to be there. God, I'd hate to be there. But I'd like to have it as a virtual location I could visit every once in a while.
Smell off some steam.
Let off some steam. Shouting things like, you know, get me, you know, get somebody on the phone. Give me the mayor.
You're out of order.
Yeah. What's your badge?
I'm going on to the meatpacking district.
I'm going to meat. I'm going to Tommy Tang Street in the meatpacking district.
You're off the case, McGartigal. There he is, sharpening his sword. And I don't mean that as a
euphemism, city. Here we go.
Oh, man, Frankie Howard would have had a great supporting role in this.
Spotlights blaring in through the windows.
Yeah. Oh, she just so happens to have written a large, photogenic, hardback book on metal sword me. Oh, McLeod's looking a bit.
He's just going to go back to polish his sword. He's looked at her picture and now he's back to polishing his sword.
Symbolism.
Oh, yeah.
No, it's like he just opened up his browser. He looked at the picture and he thought, yeah, I'll go back to cleaning my sword.
Here we go.
Another transition. Look at this transition. Isn't that nice?
That's the best one yet.
Yeah, it's great. The fish tank to the lake and Sean Connery rowing and then just getting pissed off with Christopher Lambert.
This is...
You complain endlessly.
Stolen
this. What is haggish?
They might have stolen this scene from The Karate Kid, now in all fairness.
This is what, 86? What was Karate Kid?
Karate Kid is 84.
Okay. Another bit where Miss Miyagi then, like, got decapitated.
Yeah.
That was part three.
Sweep the head off.
Now, get out. Yeah. In he goes.
Connor, son.
Now we have the most, the pretty slightly, pulling my punches here, unconvincing, tank. You can't drown, you fool. You're immortal. Underwater shot.
One of the most unrealistic things about this film is that you could possibly see your hand in front of your face in a lake in Scotland. Because you just know it's just full of silt. Look at this. Oh, it does look
full of Loch Ness monsters.
Yeah. Oh, there you go, yeah.
I can breathe. And he's going to like try sword fight. He's going to like whack my sword at some seaweed. That's playing around here.
He's just sitting on a rock. He's just sitting on a rock at the bottom of the lake.
To be fair, shooting underwater is not fun for anyone.
I don't know how they do it.
Did you do it?
I would never be able to open my eyes underwater and see. Like, I watched a video of a Disneyland mermaid. Where her entire gig was floating around in a tank and kids would come up and she would blow kisses against the glass, come up for air every so often, but she would have to keep her eyes open underwater the entire time. And I just thought, you'd be blinded.
God.
Surely there's chlorine in that water.
Hey! Human eyes are not designed for seeing through water. So you
maybe if they wore contact lenses, I don't know.
I guess so. Oh, the fish coming out of his kilt. Great. You cannot die, McLeod. Except...
So they do have pockets in those kilts.
Unless the fish are just like up his ass or something.
Yeah, I was just thinking. He just clenched. Jamie, did you do... Look, watch the there's a match shot there. Do you see the top half of that tower?
Are you saying this isn't a real tower?
I'm saying the lower.
That's
bit
a very
of
convincing map shot, if that's the case.
Oh, you can so see the lines on the map painting. It's quite good, just for that tower bit. Yeah,
I could. What are you gonna? What were you gonna ask me, Will?
Did you have underwater shot in Pilgrimage?
We did actually. Yeah, we shot it. Stanley Weber gets he gets dragged underwater. I think at the end, shot.
Oh, it's so expensive to shoot in water. Oh, it's amazing you actually got it. We couldn't do anything underwater.
It is very expensive.
Do you have to bring in a whole team, a specific team to do that?
There, yeah, well,
and insurance and safety people.
Shooting underwater, there's just, because there was another project I was working on, underwater stuff, and I remember the producer taking me aside and saying, listen, you can afford to shoot maybe, was it like 5% of the script? We can shoot actors in diving, like wearing diving masks and things underwater. That's it. Or like, it was 7 pages, I think. He said, you got 7 pages. That's it. I was like, we can't, it's just everything you do underwater is like, you're quadrupling your the takes you're going to do. You're just increasing the chances of accidents. Problem. It's not, no one wants to shoot underwater. It's very problematic.
Price. I've a friend who just posted a picture of him shooting an insert of a scene in his next film that takes place underwater, where he needed a shot of the guy unscrewing a certain device underwater. Mm-hmm. And so he sent me a picture of what looked like a dunk tank. You know, the tanks that you get dunked into in... Like a BAFTA tank or whatever they call them in Star Wars. Like one of those things.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And the camera crew are on the other side filming, and the actor is in the tank submerged with the sort of the panel, and they're shooting it that way to shoot the underwater.
Right. So it's a relatively small size. So the crew are outside.
Shooting it through glass, essentially. Through, like through he's glass, in a fish tank.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But, yeah, and they had a lot of favors to pull to do that.
Jesus. So see these moves that they're practicing right now. That was most of my childhood when I was alone as well, just doing this stuff.
It's like Lord of the Dance.
Yeah, it was either I would have a sword, and we did a predator commentary recently. I would have my predator machine gun with grenade launcher, homemade grenade launcher attached underneath, and I would have my sword down my back that I could just wield when I needed to draw it out, and I knew all the moves, and I could do the crane kick as well.
I had an idea for a spin. I didn't know who to pitch it to. I was like, you know, it'd be a great fucking what was it, IP collision, Highlander versus Predator.
Yeah.
Oh wow, that's an actual really good one.
Yeah. Well, it's yeah, because he could.
Oh my god. Follow that through.
Yeah.
Well, no.
Predator is one of the Highlanders.
You got a Predator. It's like, you know, the Highlanders are, or whatever the Immortals are. Yeah, they're, you know, obviously Immortals.
Am I doing the Die Hard thing of calling John McClane Die Hard by calling...
Calling him Predator. Just call them all Highlanders. You know what? Let's call them all Predators. Highlanders versus Predators.
Yeah. I know. I think it's fair enough to call them Highlanders, Kevin,
because you know, if they jump into the lake.
Oh, he's wearing boxer party. Shorts. I saw him. Yeah. This movie's fake as fuck.
So,
actually, isn't
fighting on a mountain
that guys go commando under kilts?
Well. Not me,
isn't
anyway.
Just a,
whenever I wear my kilt, my breakfast kilt, it's always commando.
True is, he knocked his sword down the side of that fucking mountain. And it's like, well, that well done for. We could have probably sparred somewhere where we don't have to, you know, fucking arrows to like find my sword again.
It's like ball burst again, lads. Thanks.
Oh, you disarm me now. It's like, yeah, I'll be back. I'll be back in 6 hours. We'll continue.
Fuck's
this.
Sake, Highlander. I'm not joking. I even just watching this with you lads yabbering in the background. This film has just given me, tickling me, and making me. It's an enjoyable film. It's a romp. That's what it is.
It's a movie. Is like this is as Kevin pointed out. This is the movie where someone like will cartwheel out of a car park rather than just like you know walking away, which would be the normal thing to do. But obviously, the cool thing to do is to like cartwheel, to do like backflips out of it. You should always backflipping, always backflipping.
I think there's a lot of these the interesting camera moves and how well it's shot, essentially. I think that was ingrained in me when I was a kid as well, because when I came to the third film, I remember just feeling, it doesn't look as good as the first one. And I was a kid watching the third film, but I could tell it didn't have the same level of quality.
Have you watched the second one? Do you recall?
I haven't seen the second one since the time I took three classmates to watch it with me in the cinema. I believe I told a story and almost lost all my friends. Yeah. I almost lost all my friends because I said, the sequel to the best film is in the cinema. We have to see it. And
I remember seeing like Hard Boiled, I think, like renting that in VHS in like 1995 or something, whatever it was. And then I was like, coming into like school the next day, I have seen the future of cinema and it is Hard fucking Boiled.
Yeah.
I'm persuading no one got it. They didn't click. They're like, stupid. Like,
they didn't watch it. They didn't watch it.
They didn't get it.
Losers. Losers.
Yeah, they were losers. And I think I took a bunch of people to see Face Off as well in college, and I don't know, that was a slightly similar situation.
I hated Face Off on release, and then I quite liked it rewatching it recently, because the film is fucking insane.
Yes.
And I was able to go along with it a lot better this time. But the first time I watched it, I thought, this film is, it's not cool. This film is so dumb.
Maybe that's the thing with Hard Boiled. I don't know. The first time I saw that, I was like, oh my God, this is fucking brilliant. Like, I've never seen anything, an action movie that's shot like a musical. Like, it's just insane.
That single take in the hospital, wasn't in the hospital that they go through different floors. Was utterly incredible. It really was utter. It's a single take, you know, shootout. It's fucking amazing.
Oh, yeah.
Would you like living in? I know they got a couple of stories, but like still, they could get a bit
central
more.
Heating would central be heat. Unreal.
Yeah,
but I mean, is the back? I mean, my kind of like headcanon for this is like that. You know, he found this shitty castle in the middle of nowhere and just like moved in. Yeah. Because, like, you know, obviously he didn't build a fucking thing. But it's like, I don't know, wouldn't everyone, all these people like wandering around, there's like a disused castle over there. Like, fuck, there'd be like full of people.
Of course it would, yeah. There would be a whole village living around it.
Yeah.
I wonder how long they shot for.
Let's ask Dr. Wikipedia.
There you go. I was just except I'm going to see my face light up again. Because I'm
going to take a guess that they shot for 6 months.
Okay.
Because there's a lot of unit moves.
I'd say all that Scotland stuff, that's all within like probably like 20, 30 kilometers. Like there's not that much. They're staying within like they've got a unit base. And then they're like shooting within that.
Yeah, I guess.
And the New York stuff, well, so far, has all seemed to be like the stage
stuff.
And then there's the.
It's just they used to take more time back then to make films. They wouldn't bang out a film in like 21 days.
I introduced myself to the lady that was there.
Oh, Sean Connery. Would you like more wine? They wouldn't have. No, I don't think this is historically. Oh, he sensed Clancy Brown. Or he smelled a fart. One of the two. Probably.
I bet John Woo liked this movie.
Oh, yeah. Wouldn't you say all, so? All those pigeons and doves? Yes.
Yeah.
Here he comes. That's it. Look at that hair.
I do.
He is massive.
Yeah, I like your man Gregory Widen's backstory, his original draft, Kurgan, being just a knight, a noble knight who was driven insane by being immortal. Whereas apparently Clancy Brown was like, I kind of like that. Like but they were like, no, we want you to be a punk. And he was like, no, apparently I heard Clancy Brown was going, but you wouldn't know if you saw him in the present day, he'd be like an executive, you know, you wouldn't know that he was he wouldn't be like literally the guy you're going to say, who do you think is going to cut off a head? It's like, well, it's probably that crazy guy there with the brief, the weird like briefcase with sword bits inside it.
Where is Highlander at the moment?
He's off stuffing houses.
He's the Highlander.
They did make some excuse for why he wasn't on set. I was just glancing there, and they were reading up on how the producers were trying to cut costs any way they could. Now you
die. They had a sort of a cheapness to them, even though there was a ton of money spent on them. You cannot win, Ramirez. I am the strongest. My cut has improved your voice.
One of the ways they said here as an example was that on the first day of filming, they decided that the extras wouldn't get any food. So the crew threatened to leave, and then one of the assistant directors brought Connery in, and Connery basically pushed the issue, and it was because Sean Connery got them to the extras could eat because of Sean Connery. It was in Scotland as well.
Yeah, he's not going to fuck around
Connery
in Scotland.
Connery would have lived that down. We did a Connery movie and they never fed us.
No, it's... can't be voting for Scottish independence. I love how this castle, this wonderful set, gets like destroyed by like Clancy Brown just like whacking it with his sword a few times, and it's like and it's like he catches on fire.
But I'm transported back to 8-year-old me, and it was me. His sword was kind of like He-Man's sword or something like that. It had so much power that it could literally topple buildings.
This is the kind of stuff that when I would be watching films as a kid, I would also be inside the movie making process and imagining how cool it would have been to have actually been there as they're making it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I really like how he whacked the sword there. Oh, and then it's just like, he hits Sean Connery, and then like there's a random wall just falls down behind him.
Yeah. A whole section of it.
Oh, that's pretty badass, though, pulling out a sword from your stomach. Yeah.
That's been mimicked in several films. Excuse me.
Yeah.
He's always just happy when he kills somebody.
Yeah.
He's just a happy guy, the Kurgan. Like, to be fairness, he's just really, really happy. Like, he positive
enjoys
role
his job.
Models. Mm. Yeah, he does. He really does enjoy
behind.
It. Yeah. Oh well, now they're getting like the. Who is
the woman? Hey, remember
his hair.
Remember, I said it's like he's going to nibble his earlobe, Sean Connery's earlobe. He's just so close to just nibbling that earlobe.
And they spent 2 weeks filming this, and then he sticks his tongue out.
Tonight you sleep in hell. Well, you know.
Oh, he's got his hands. He's like, see the way Connery was posed, as if his hands, he was praying.
My God, he's going to be okay.
Why? We might get that head stitched back on.
Just a bit of flesh wound. It's Clancy Brown going across the up above and beyond for like doing his eyes there.
Yeah,
doing the old white eyes.
I think Tommy Wiseau liked this movie.
And it's like
she plays a good part.
Oh,
see, back in the 80s they had great roles for women.
There was so much variety. There was wench, there was damsel in distress, there was untrustworthy uppity metallologist,
and there was witch, and that was it.
Oh, there was secretary as well. Sorry, we forgot about secretary.
Yes, secretary. And I think we're going to see the secretary in this.
Yeah.
And I think the secretary is actually a really established actress.
Oh, really?
Yes. I'm afraid that won't be possible.
Good morning. This is Brenda Wyatt,
Mr. That actress right there.
We've already met, Rachel. What can I do for you?
Yeah, what's her fucking name?
The kind of woman who takes advice.
That depends.
Advice about what?
Actress.
What's her name? Rachel
Highlander.
Mm. Sheila Gish.
The character.
Yeah, big stage actress.
Here we go.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah.
Long. She's still going.
Great roles for women.
Holy shit, she's still going. Mansfield Park.
I still think that Sean Connery's alive.
Unfortunately, Sean Connery passed, Kevin.
I know, but don't you think that his persona was so huge that it doesn't feel like he's passed?
He's a true movie star. He's someone that when you see his characters, because he was always old. I think even when you saw him in Bond, he was kind of old, even though he was in his early 30s.
As long as there's people around to do bad impressions of him, you'll never die.
Oh, cutie. I can't do it now. I can't do it. What are you looking at,
Rachel? Sean. Get to the chopper.
He's best rolled that one. and this is one of the relationships.
Here
we go. This is the missing scene for American Cut. This is a scene this is back in World War II.
The actual lens just smashed.
Yeah. And it almost looked like a 3D.
This is the scene. I had to rewind this about 20 times when I was a kid. I was like, I'd watch the scene. And I was like, what the fuck is he saying?
Oh, is it
so we see
Jack something that he's kind of like kill off line?
What have you said, Jack? You're the man to raise. I was like, oh, okay, that sounds interesting. What do I think? And it was back in the days of VHS, so you didn't have subtitles. I'm like, I'd rewind it. It's like, what do you say, Jack? You're the man to raise. Okay, that's maybe getting better.
My God.
I bet you it was one of...
Why, can I just ask, though, why was this cut from the American release?
I actually don't know. I think they spoke about it. Was it length? Was it a case that they were just trying to make these films shorter to get more screenings in?
It's a kind of magic. Obviously,
yeah,
Queen fan. You die.
And I think the scene is really endearing because it helps the Rachel character then. Why is Rachel with
him? We're getting to it now.
Yeah.
Whatever you say, Jack, you're the master race.
And it's the way he delivers it. It's so hard to understand what he's saying. You're the master race.
Yeah, I understood it. But the subtitles just were up there and it's like, what did you say, Jack?
Again, Kevin, what are those lights you were on about? Is it halo lights outside?
No, I've got it wrong. They're halogen lights. They're like halogen massive, the ones that they use to basically light a street.
Okay.
They will bounce them to make it look like moonlight.
Mm-hmm. They're just belted.
I mean, basically, this woman is his daughter.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which I kind of, that's the kind of
weird...
Oh,
she's a little girl, isn't it? That's right.
Yeah. So
it's all coming back to me now.
That's what, oh God, why can't I recall that song?
Who Wants to Live Forever?
No, It's All Coming Back to Me Now. Sorry.
Freddie Mercury.
Yeah, Freddie Mercury famously sang that song.
Man, they could have fit Freddie Mercury into a cameo in this fucking movie. Maybe just one a random immortal who gets murdered.
He could play Kurgan.
Oh, man.
Those teeth.
That'd be awesome.
He could just nibble through his neck.
Well, there's another English actor, what's his name? Quarchy, I think, who we're going to see in about 10 minutes here. An old friend of McLeod's. I was like, yeah, you could have Freddie Mercury in that role.
Has she done anything since this?
Brenda, probably.
Let's have Brenda, I got her. Oh, she's been in
Roxanne Hart.
Yeah, the good girl. She was at Robin Williams' film License to Wed. The Verdict. She was also in. Where are
you going? Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Make yourself a drink. There are glasses in the bar.
So she's been in a bunch of films.
When did Christopher Lambert go away? I remember seeing Fortress, and I've not seen him in anything since.
He's in that Coen Brothers movie, Hail Caesar.
Yeah, he's in Hail
Caesar.
Who
was he in that?
He's the director in that who...
It must have been a very small part.
It was a cameo. It was pretty good, though.
Right. I saw that film.
He's still...
I don't remember him.
He's still making films. There might be European films and stuff like that, but he's definitely still... Yeah, it's a lot of European films.
God, that's so sad.
Making European films.
Because three Irish filmmakers like sneering at European movies. Yeah. Interesting view. And there's like excellent raincoat. I had a use of raincoat that was almost exactly like that, except it made me look like a douchebag.
Yeah, I've never had a raincoat. I would look terrible wearing a raincoat.
So those type of raincoats, like, are they obviously? I wonder how. I don't know what they feel like. You know, remember wax jackets? Did you ever have a wax jacket?
Yeah, I tell you, loved wax jackets. Wax jackets were like the uniform for school.
Yeah, but they had a weird texture to them. I just could never.
What were the wedges shoes called?
Hennessy. Okay, so he's got a cognac here. You got a Hennessy cognac, yeah. That's from, like, I don't know. It's like some stupid amount of year old, isn't it? What year is it? I really like this scene. It's like, the year.
Brandy.
1783.
Wow, that's old.
Old. Not as old as me.
It was a very good year. I like that. You see, I like these time traveling elements. Great mess.
The Montgolfier brothers went up in their first balloon. Kind of dumb, but there's something about like Christopher Lambert's weird, like just out there voice and the really tight focus on his face as the camera's like zooming in.
I'm with you,
in.
Jamie. I'm with you.
It works. I don't know.
There's an alchemy to it that is so charming.
Yeah, I think like that amount of old brandy is probably better than like the, what was that Jennifer Lopez movie where like, hey, I got you a first copy of the Iliad or something, a signed copy.
Oh god. I used to actually, before I finished drinking, I used to drink brandy as my tipple of choice. I would. If I had something in the house, I would
really
be brandy. Yeah.
Good choice.
But my heart would be beating like
anytime I've had
the next day.
Anytime I've had brandy, I immediately break out in a sweat. I'm like roasting.
It's not good for your heart, brandy. Just, you'd be like a racehorse. Sitting outside watching your apartment.
You remember him. Mine's hitting tailing me. I'm going to finish my wine, and I'm not going to go on to... What do I have there?
How many centuries do you think it would take for yourself to go insane if you were immortal?
The way it's looking, just under the one.
Yeah.
Just under the one, Kevin.
One will do it.
One would definitely do it.
Yeah, it's a nice... It's a nice idea, I think. I'd like to see them sort of doing that and exploring that idea.
Doing what?
This thing about the idea of being being an immortal, like the idea of a lifespan that spanned more than say 80 to 100 years, like what that would do to a person's psyche is kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to have there been any other films that kind of played with it. In outside of this type particular genre,
I remember being in a meeting where there was a movie in development, and the idea was where we have a certain edit name of actor, big Hollywood actor, and it's going to play an immortal, but it's like it's some kind of a it's not magic, it's basically just like a gene, a weird fucking. Biological fluke, yeah. And he's immortal. And we, okay.
Steven Seagal.
No, well, sure. Look, I'll get into this when the mics aren't rolling.
Yeah.
But, and then I remember, like, Steven I just, Seagal. And it was like, I was like, yeah, but you mean like Highlander? And they're like, no, but like, you know, he's just like, he just like, lives longer. And I just, but that,
God damn it, Jamie, why do you keep bringing up Highlander?
I kept ruining the pitch because they kept being like, but you mean like Highlander? It's like, I can't. I was like, fuck that. It's like, say Highlander. Anyway.
God.
So anyway, this is the no, Who Wants to Live Forever? Queen's really terrific fucking song from this, I gotta say. Real ballad moment here.
It absolutely cracking. And if you wanted any proof that that was a matte painting of that tower, there's the runes in the background, and they just stuck some matte. It definitely was a matte painting earlier on.
I think you might be ahead of me, Will.
Really?
Well, are you looking at Christopher Lambert is approaching a croft and he's about to see...
No, he's already there. I'm looking at him. Oh, yeah. He's approaching the hay barrels.
He's walking over and he's going to look over and he's going to see...
He's looking down.
The
Heather.
Worst.
He just said Heather.
Yeah.
Okay, we're all together.
He's like, oh my God.
This is a bit... No, she's old. This is the bit that I love about this film. We see that... And it's the music as well. It's just to see her aging and him still being young. And he really does... They're still in love, like, you know? But I do love it. It's kind of heartbreaking.
To be fairness, she just does look like she walked through a flour mill.
She still walks like a 21-year-old.
Yeah. But the idea is very strong.
Her character's probably only 40 right there. You know, if we were being accurate to what the life expectancy of people was like in the 1600s or whatever.
She's our age. She's what you're saying.
What I read is that people did not die a lot younger as you go back through the centuries. It's just that infant mortality was so much higher that it adjusts what the average lifespan was in that case.
Right.
But also so many women died in childbirth that
horrible.
If you weren't giving birth and you're as a teenager, then it's all over.
It's not
for
advisable.
You.
Yeah. It's you're things could get ropey.
I'd never go through it again.
On a random note, I was watching, during the pandemic, Kev, you watched this for the first time in the pandemic, and I rewatched this for the first time in like about 10 years or something in the pandemic. And my wife is Italian, and she's only ever seen Highlander dubbed. Watched this, and she watched it for like about 15 minutes, and she was like, what the fuck is wrong with his voice? Dubbed Christopher Lambert's dubbed voice sounds better than whatever he's talking now. We're in the Highlands. We are in the Highlands. And where else?
Mamma mia.
Running down the mountainside. I'm not going to throw shit in there. He's, you know, As Will, you pointed out, as an immortal in the present, Christopher Lambert's got a great accent because it's like, what? You're from everywhere and nowhere. But as a guy who's like, in this case, we're guessing he's probably like a 60, 70-year-old Scottish guy.
Yeah.
And he
should be pure, thick, a thick Scottish accent right now. Saying heed and shit like that. That's a cool shot. That's a cool shot, lads. It says a lot there. I love that. The McLeod so close with sword.
If you can't do wrong with like a sword stuck in the ground and someone walking away in the background, like that's it. It's your fucking
guaranteed
movie.
You're going to get an Oscar. Guaranteed. Simple as that.
Here you go. This is your man in Q course. I think this could have been Freddie Mercury's cameo as well. Well, this guy's pretty good.
Wow. And I like the fact that they meet each other. Like, it seems like 100 years. It probably has been 100 years. So, like, there's this little kind of network and community. But you know what? All of that majesty, with the new Highlander film, the mystery and that kind of disconnect is kind of gone to shit. Because they can just be WhatsApping each other the whole fucking time. It's like, how are you getting on? Yeah, did you get you decapitated yet? Nah, can't. Still have the head on.
Still here.
Yeah, still here. Yeah. There's WTF, no like.
Yeah, still here. There's LOL. There'll be no,
you would just make it that they can't use technology.
They can't kill each other.
No. It's just that they're too old. They can't fucking do it. They just can't use anything that's got a microchip in it. They just can't do it.
Why does he keep telling me lots of love? What the fuck is wrong with him?
This is another little funny. Back to 1783 here. There's a duel. I think this is great crack, actually. Two lads. They're doing a Hamilton on it.
Yeah. Which I think I sent a text message to you guys recently, which after 2 years you guys saw it, I finally got around to watching Hamilton.
And what did you think of it?
Wait until you find out who kills JR.
Yeah.
Shoots JR.
I still don't know. Okay. I'm glad to live in blissful ignorance. It is Grant. It was catchy.
Yeah.
There's a certain myth-making about American history I find really interesting compared to, like, say, Irish history and even English history, like, where the sort of failures are celebrated and kind of revered as much as... Whereas...
Can I mention something as you're saying that? I'm curious to know whether kids in other school systems in other countries, English kids, American kids, whether they're taught about their own culture through the myths that we have. Because I remember in school we were learning about Fionn MacCool and about the Salmon of Knowledge and all these sort of like myths that we're being told. And I don't know whether kids in school in England have been told Arthurian legends or
it's good.
What have you? Like, it's an interesting sort of blend into history. It was mixing history with sort of mythology.
Well, I suppose the problem we had was that, no, Jamie, you can correct me, is that our history is, so much of our history wasn't documented in the same way as, you know, English and imperialist history probably was. So we just had to go into the makey-uppy story stuff. Just say, this is history.
It's all kind of blurry because I don't know whether that was our introduction into harder stuff. So we started off learning about Queen Maeve and about, you know, the daughters that were turned into swans and all those sort of like stories. Do you guys remember that, or was it just something that happened in the Northman?
No, I remember that sort of. So yeah, we got a lot of Salmon of Knowledge. I remember those little kind of textbooks where you have those stories in them. Yeah. What about you, Jimmy?
Yeah. No, I remember them. I mean, obviously, a lot of those stories from things like the Ulster Cycle and whatnot, where they were, you know, oral history stuff from that were then recounted and then written down by the monks and whatnot. So they were always rewritten to give a certain Christian element to them. Like the Children of Lear is a good example where, like, they hear the bells of St. Patrick, whatever, and then they like that's the thing that breaks the curse. But I mean, as for Arthurian legends, I don't know. I mean, like, I found that, like, in Ireland, where we haven't been given enough of that. I think I've given more. We need more mythology, far more of it. The trouble is because it is the oral legends, and then like they hit, like, you know, from 500-600 AD, and then suddenly this, like, the only people who's writing down are monks, and so obviously they have a slanted viewpoint, and they rewrite the stories accordingly. So. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I was writing a thing years ago about that, and it was like you're trying to go back to those legends and find the stuff that's written down, and then you're trying to unpick the what would have been the Christian interpretation of it, and trying to think, okay, what would it have been like before this guy rewrote it, and then what would it have been like 200 years before that? Oh, as I'm talking, I just missed like one of the best decapitation sequence in the movie.
I had honestly forgotten about the scene. Completely forgot about the scene.
Yeah, Castigir gets his head cut off, and then the Kurgan gets machine gunned.
Yeah.
By another guy. He's one of those, like, oh, it's that guy. That guy face. You know,
I've seen that guy. Is this one of those scenes that got cut? But no, I definitely saw this. Now I'm watching it, I'm like going, no, this is a scene that I saw as a kid. So we obviously saw the European cut. So as kids.
I saw this one. I don't know. You were saying when Kev, you text me like, oh, what cut are we going to watch for this? And I was like, and what we're watching now is the cut that I watched.
Yeah.
I don't know, when I was a teenager.
Yeah, I remember this shot when I was a kid. I remember this, him lifting him up. He impales him on his sword and raises
him
up.
This is quite a violent film for an 8-year-old to be watching.
Yeah, it was class. But I think it was kind of... Again, it's not scary.
It's no RoboCop.
But this wasn't... I think it's the tone of this, Kevin. This wasn't right. Scary. It was.
This is more violent than some of the horror films that I would have been watching.
Yeah, for me, I was just... This didn't scare me at all. I just thought this was so cool. And,
I mean, look at the bullet holes in the Kurgan's vest. It looks like a design. You know, I'm sure you could...
What rating was it?
Oh, it surely was 18, 15, 18. I'd say 18. This was 18 for sure.
There you go. You got away with murder.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm not joking.
I wouldn't have been allowed to watch an 18s film.
Dude, oh no, my parents weren't a barrier as to what I put in the video player. Not at all. It was like whatever my brothers could rent as I watched.
Oh yeah, manholes blowing off. That's what you want to see. Every glass on an alleyway blowing off. Yep.
Still looks cool.
Yeah, that looks great.
Imagine how they pulled that off. Obviously, pulled it off for real. They obviously did blow the glass on several stories on either side of this alleyway.
Now the Kurgan's going to like come into your tourist car.
It's like,
that's a nice shot.
It is class.
Yeah, cuts the top off the car.
Yeah.
The guy's smiling.
That's why, Kevin, there's so many little moments of humor in this film that and the old lady's sitting on beside him. I love this.
It's just a
mom. I always found that funny.
Do you know the way it is? It's like for me watching Tremors versus you watching Tremors, that nostalgia is a hell of a thing.
Absolutely.
So if I had seen this when I was 8, like you, it would have been one of my favorite films ever.
Frank, will you take it easy? I'm telling you, I checked everywhere with everybody. There just aren't any witnesses.
That's New York for you. 20 people.
Yeah.
It would have blown my mind as a kid. But it's so batshit.
But you're right. Nostalgia is a hell of a thing. So the aspects of it that I appreciate is the production value.
And the concept. Yeah. You can't get away from the fact that the concept of an immortal guy living throughout the centuries is an incredibly strong one.
Yeah.
Like that was the thing. As a kid, as a teenager, I was like, that, you know, that's the thing.
He's Dracula.
That,
like,
yeah, but he's Dracula without the blood sucking and the look. He's a handsome, slightly myopic Frenchman. He's like, wow.
This guy survived.
Is he French or Belgian?
Oh, good question.
Sorry, Kevin.
Well, Christopher Lambert. I'm gonna say he's French.
Guys, he's an American-born French actor. Yeah, he was born in Brooklyn. I actually remember that.
What?
So he's an American-born French actor. Yeah, he
I
was born in
he
Brooklyn.
Was Belgian?
No.
Three big board battle rifles.
Yeah, that's what it is.
And I ain't safe. I can't
protect myself. He was married to Diane Lane. I didn't know that for like 7 years.
I did know that. And it's like,
wow,
that memory.
Lucky
what
man.
Use is that? Mm. What use is that in my head to know that? Anyway. And look, oh, nice overhead shot there.
You know what the name of his production company is? Christopher Lambert's production company.
Squinty Films.
No, it's Lambert. It's Lambert's studio.
That's clever.
Mm.
I would have gone with Squinty. You pick up the phone in the office. Hello, Squinty. What?
Hi, Squinty.
That guy has a pretty huge bowl of fruit for, like, I'm guessing this is a public hospital.
I just, you know that's the cinematographer.
How do you play Satan?
We need some color. Look at the way he's doing the. Oh my God! Look at the hot dog. He's just kind of picking up. Oh God! Imagine.
What does incompetent mean?
Would you ever eat street food in New York?
Oh fuck! I did.
I have.
Oh, I would as well.
Yeah, but now I'm a little bit more hesitant. But I definitely did.
Because of COVID?
I don't know. Now I've been warned about it.
Wait, am I? Oh no! Wait, what's the? Where is this? I thought for a second this was What's this location? This library woman's in?
I don't know. I've never been. Same, in it.
Records. This is where she finds out that like Nash or Connor McLeod is like an immortal. He's been.
Couldn't she just like faking. Google it? Like,
yeah.
On her Amstrad. On Wikipedia.
First place, Syracuse. Okay. Let's look for his date of birth. So yeah, she's trying to suss out who Nash is. That's what she's doing.
And he's like, he died years ago.
He's Greg Widen. What else did he write?
He did Backdraft.
The Prophecy.
Did he really?
Mm-hmm.
Did he really? Okay.
Yep.
Fair play, Widen.
He didn't do too much, but I can tell you right now.
Well, I mean, The Prophecy, they made about four fucking movies out of that, at least. At least two or three.
Imagine the residuals. Oh, my God.
Yeah. Backdraft 2.
Which only came out a few years ago. They made a second
one? Yeah, in 2019. And another film called Other Life, which I don't know anything about.
That one's great.
Yeah, that was fantastic. But yeah. So he's really actually doesn't have that many credits. He has just 1, 2, 3, about.
My God, that's so embarrassing. Could you imagine being a writer and not having that many credits?
But for someone who wrote The Highlander in 1986, you would assume they would have gotten a shit ton of, you know, action movie jobs after that.
Whenever I see a writer doesn't have a long list of credits, I just know it's down to them just not being any good.
Oh yeah, it's, you know, what other explanation could there be?
I like this program they have here.
It's a personal failing, and I just blame them.
Here. They have. I like this signature program they have to match up the writing.
And the guy who's explaining, like, he's been around since, you know, this basically, he just explains, like, McLeod's backstory.
Yeah.
And he's just like, he's in this for, like, about maybe 45 seconds, and then it's like, you never see him again.
Yeah.
And it's silly because she's the one doing the investigating. She should be the one that uncovers this by herself.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Technically, I mean, you know, she does. She asked this guy and he told her who it was. But
we saw a news vendor, a street vendor there, and I was just wondering, why is he wearing a cooking apron when he's inside? He was wearing a cooking apron in the in his news agent hut.
Because he likes to wipe his hands off his apron.
Oh, okay, fair enough. Here we got another Holy Ground scene. I've never quite. Yeah. The Holy Ground.
Yes.
Something that is like in the Highlander mythology, mortals cannot kill each other or fight on holy ground.
Jamie just sent me a text message saying he has to go to the Jacks.
No. Yeah. I was trying to keep it like on the slide while I
we're going to leave the recording going and we're going to see how long it takes you.
Go on, bring us with
you. So Jamie is now leaving to go to the Jacks.
Yeah, take my earphones off, okay? Ready?
No, leave them on.
But here, look
you
at this.
You can hear us talking to you while you're on the Jacks.
No, stop. So the Kurgan comes into the same church. And he goes up to the candles. And I just love the punk attitude of him just like swatting out the candles. Just been a pure little shit.
Like Jamie.
Kevin.
You're such a child. So, is this a good film to end the run of commentaries on? Are you enjoying it?
I am having a ball, Kevin. I am actually having a ball because I haven't watched this film in at least 15 years, I would say.
Really?
I got it on DVD when it back in the era of DVD, so that was early 2000s, and I haven't watched it since. And it's been a pleasure.
Oh, look at you! Look did at the, not wash your hands, Jimmy. You did not.
That's why he's got an apron, Kevin. Just
fucking brilliant. Set up payoff.
Look at this performance. Look at totally this. Totally wish, like, man. He is so cool.
Kurgan is so fun in this.
He is so much fun. The fucking shape of his head. The shape of his head. And the tormenting the nuns. It's great crack. And Jamie, I had actually forgotten the whole thing about the Holy Ground thing, which I think is another cool aspect of mythology.
Yeah, it doesn't... I mean, I think Highlander 3, at some point, there's a point where, like, who the fuck is it? Mario Van Peebles tries to kill Christopher Lambert, and like a wall blows down or something, and like all this, like a holy wind like blows across the soundstage, and he was like, "Oh, I guess it's holy ground. I guess I won't kill you, but no."
If I was a Highlander and I was just feeling really lazy, and I wanted to be lazy for like a lifetime, I would just take up residence in a church. And just go, I'm living here now. Not going to fight anyone.
I believe the Highlander TV series did do something along those lines.
Right. Who's giggling?
Kevin's only now sending me his text message in reply to my text message about the toilet.
You will always be weaker than I. Shouldn't it
go
be
for
me?
It. Kevin, you'll be delighted to hear I did go for it.
Wow.
Holy ground, Highlander.
Oh, is that a tattoo on his head?
I'm only noticing it now, too. Yeah. I'd never noticed that before.
I thought it was just his hair.
It's like a dragon. He's got a dragon tattooed to his scalp. That's pretty cool. So he got that dragon tattooed to his scalp, grew his hair out long, like a metal.
But if you're immortal, I mean, how does that work with scars and tattoos and things? I mean, I get tattoos, okay, there's ink there, I could stay, but like,
you just keep healing over.
Yeah, but he's still got like a throaty voice when Sean Connery like cut his throat, so. Oh no. Father, forgive me.
The size of him.
I am a worm. He's a big man.
Isn't it great?
That's a big bitch.
He's so menacing. He's so menacing.
I have something to say. It's better to burn out than to fade away.
Yeah, bitches.
Is that a line from one of the Queen songs?
I'm trying to think. Is it something from My
It sounds
Way?
Very familiar.
Is it like a My Way, a lyric from My Way? I'm not sure. Because they did, for this film, Queen did a cover of My Way.
Yeah. I hate that song.
Not even the Sex Pistols cover. Or what's his name?
I just hate the sentiment of that song. I hate the whole thing of like, well, fuck y'all, I did it my way.
It wouldn't be something I'd play at my funeral, Kevin.
Yeah.
Because I'd be dead.
I think
I've heard it a few times at funerals. Actually,
oh, really?
It's always bastards justifying their sort of like dickishness.
Shit, yeah.
Yeah, I was a shit, but I did it my way.
So Christopher Lambert is now invited the metallurgist over to look at his toys. He's such a nerd, you know. In real life, it'd be like, look at my weapons.
Welcome to my conversation pit.
Yeah.
Is that what you're calling it?
Yeah, the conversation.
That's what they're actually called.
They're kind of cool.
That's the official name for them, a conversation pit. They were big in the 60s and 70s.
Have you ever
I'm been... Connor McLeod of the Clan McLeod.
Step into my conversation pit.
All the immortals. All the immortals have conversation pits.
apparently, it is better to burn out than fade away is a... it's a misquoting of a Neil Young song.
Oh, okay.
I thought it might have been that
Connor McLeod of the Clan McLeod, and I cannot die.
I thought it might have been the VHS tape. Stop motion skeleton selling the fact that you could re-record over VHS tapes.
Re-record, not fade away. Re-record, not fade away.
You can watch Scotch forever.
Re-record, not fade away.
Nobody, and I mean nobody, will know what I meant with that.
I'm with you. I'm with you.
So he sort of makes her stab him. If my memory of this is correct, is there a sex scene now?
Yep, there definitely was. It seems to be very late in the film to have it, but I think if we're going to have it, it's going to happen now. It really
She's
is.
She's like, oh my God, I stabbed you, but you're not dead. That's so sexy.
Sexy. You've got
I
blood
want you
on
inside me.
That is so hot right now. And then, oh yeah, and then, wow, that is...
It's very weird structure, this film, because... Are these the love interests, the leads?
But the thing I find
to be happening though, 20 minutes towards the end, like,
but I disagree, because I find that the love interest is that woman. Here we go, Kevin. There you go. Say it one last time. Say it one last time, Kevin. For
nipple.
There we go. For our last audio commentary.
Silhouette of a nipple.
Butt crack.
Christopher Lambert works out.
Nipples and buttocks.
Oh, it's good to see he waxed in a way. And now we've got a tiger cut to a tiger.
You'd imagine, I guess, if you were immortal, you'd probably be all you've done everything. Like, you've been into all kinds of freaky shit.
Mm-hmm. I'd assume
you've
so.
Done
yeah,
the Kama Sutra front to back.
That's why he has a conversation pit. It's also called a sex pit.
Step into my sex dungeon.
Yeah. Oh,
isn't that creepy in the background? Yeah, you can see Kurgan just in silhouette in the background right there.
I was going to say about those raincoats. The thing about them that is I really liked, it made me look like a sex criminal, but what I really liked about them is that they're incredibly light. Like you barely feel like you're wearing anything at all.
What I want to ask you, Jamie, about these raincoats, are they actually water resistant?
Pretty much.
They soak it up.
Yes.
Yeah, because I'm something that looks so light and flimsy, it seems that the water would just like go through it like a tissue. Well, that's good to know.
No, it's like, you know, you've got you've rain covers on your pram and
I know.
Giving your babies, and those things are pretty thin, but
yeah.
Also, as human beings, we're waterproof. So we don't really need a raincoat. We're just protecting our clothing. So we should go naked.
You should go naked.
He made her stab him. She realized he was immortal. She kissed him, and then they went really quickly into a sex scene, and then they went to the zoo, and then she got kidnapped. This is not a great day for Brenda, the CSI lady.
It's not.
Or the best day ever.
Let me put it, or not the great afternoon. I love Clancy Brown when he's driving, like, I'm covering my eyes.
This is the reason why this film didn't scare me, because of the fun that Clancy Brown is having with his character, where he's driving on the wrong side of the road and screaming in terror along with her. It's funny.
See, that's the stuff that I would have leaned into, where I've got two heroes that cannot die, so they would just be doing the most impossible death-defying set pieces over and over again and having fun with it.
Mm-hmm. And if you were doing a
to be fair, the actress looks like she's doing. Oh, and he runs someone over. Like he's taking this entirely seriously, or she is. Sorry, but Clancy Brown's like, oh fuck this. I'm like a 1,000-year-old Russian immortal. And there are like literally no fucks left to give. I threw them to the starving dogs to fight over.
Hey, and look there—they're just having car crashes in the far distance of some of these shots. They're just throwing them away, not properly milking them. They're just going to go, yeah, whatever. Just smash some cars against each other. Those cannon... What was the name of the cannon guys? Oh, I can't remember their names.
Menahem? Menahem?
Yeah.
No. Jimmy and John Joe.
No. Golem. Golem? Was there a Golem? Golan?
Menheim and... they were Israelis, weren't they?
Yeah. There was Golan, or Golem was one of them.
There's a really good documentary on that, actually. The Canon documentary.
Yeah.
That I saw, and I really liked it, and I can't remember it.
Electric Boogaloo.
That was it.
Yeah, it's excellent.
Slow motion motorbike guy goes over the top. I find it crazy. It's funny that, like, that's the thing that, like, sends her over the edge.
I'm telling you to shut up.
I knocked over this pizza guy. Yeah. He's like, oh, no, I'm just driving over the... I'm driving over the bridge. Oh, the silver cup. Which turns up in a couple of other movies have referenced the silver cup building.
She fainted. Women used to faint a lot in the 80s.
Well, you know, the air was thinner then.
Also, you could knock fellas out by just slapping them on the back of the neck.
They obviously have given out... But things have progressed into the 80s because we've been watching films from the previous decade, Kevin, recently. And back in the previous decade, if a woman fainted, you were just completely...
Slap her.
Yeah, you would just slap her. That was... And at least things have moved on. You don't see as many female slapping scenes happening in 80s movies.
So, I mean, I've forgotten this as like a... The endless killings are driven him mad. But... he just wants to have a sword fight with him. I mean, he's not trying to, like, you know, trick him. He just wants to, like, cut his head off.
Mm-hmm.
He's like the school bully. He's just not going to stop until he fights him.
Mm-hmm. Just teasing him and teasing him and teasing him.
But it's not like MacLeod is not going to fight him. I mean, MacLeod is like, well, listen, you murdered my mentor and, you know, violated my first wife. I probably would be like, I have some kind of need to avenge myself on you. Apart from the fact that you stabbed me years ago.
Yeah. How many years ago? 300 years ago? 400 years
ago? 400? Yeah.
Yeah. 400. Yeah.
It's okay. He's a kind of magic. Then he goes in the elevator.
I'd like if he turned around to her and said, Radio Gaga. Goodbye, Nash. All we hear is Radio
Barcelona.
I see a little silhouette of the net.
I was just going to do that. So they have the big set. They're having their big climax fight here on that. What's the name? Silver what? Silver Cup sign?
Silver Cup.
They also shot the Queen music video here as well, because Christopher Lambert is in it. So they actually used this location and shot.
Someone, what was it that? Oh God, what's that Australian horror director did recent Diabolical, Insidious? Give me very recent.
James Wan.
Baz Luhrmann.
Yeah.
James Wan.
No, I'm joking.
Oh.
What was the last horror movie he did?
Did you see Australia?
He did a movie with what's her face?
Malignant.
And that has a reference to this in it. Apparently, there's a silver cup building thing in it, which he did as a shout out apparently to his fellow Australian.
Did you see Malignant?
I haven't. I was reading a review and they were mentioning, like, oh, there was a shout-out to, like, Silver Cup. Obviously, this is, like, a reference to Highlander. And then, apparently, I followed the Twitter exchange, and yes, it was. It was exactly what it was.
I need to get on Twitter.
Nah, you don't want to do that. You don't want to do that. I like these swords, which, like, set so many sparkles up when they, like, whack things with them.
I need it when I'm starting my fire.
They're glitter ones.
Where's my fire starting sword again? Just
Kurgan's just like whacking this fucking the silver cup signing down.
And I like the kind of pirouette he's doing in order to
achieve his goals. Yeah, it's nice. It's nice. The Kurgan has no respect for copyright.
Yeah.
Like ballet.
I mean, that is, if Oh, and all the letters of the Silver Cup sign start falling off. It's nice. Yes. Oh, it's beautiful. And the water tower. Of course there's a water tower going to fall off.
They did spend money making this film.
I mean, Jesus, that was like close to 20 million. Like, what would that get you today?
Well, like Die Hard.
Almost get you a one bedroom in Dublin.
Die Hard was Die Hard only 16 million or am I going completely wrong on that one? Maybe Die Hard is a bit more.
Probably not. I'd say you're probably in that ballpark, to be fair.
Like, it's a decent budget. When you think Star Wars was the first Star Wars was 12 million.
No, because think about it. True Lies was the first film to have a box off to have a budget of 100 million, and that was what, 92? So 5 years before that, they wouldn't have gone from like 16 million up to 100 million.
Okay,
it would have been a slow creep up to 45, 50 million.
Oh, let's see. Okay, just see how far off I am. Budget 25 to 35 million was Die Hard.
There you go. Yeah. So I was right.
Yeah.
Slightly. It would be funny if it was the L that fell on top of him, so he takes a massive L. But they didn't know what was coming down the pipe. Gaming references. Did they even have video games back then?
Sure they did.
Yeah.
I love the hand-drawn electricity effects. It's so nice.
It's so much. It's so fun. It adds the fantasy element. Adds to this fantasy element.
Yeah. Yeah. The fact that they're wading around on the roof of the Silver Cup building.
So they're being electrocuted as they're fighting.
Falling. Yeah. I guess so, because they're immortal. It's like, who gives a fuck?
And now
that's a cool idea.
As they fell from a height of a good 50 feet right there. You know the way they still suffer injuries? Both of them should have shattered ankles.
I think this is like...
So stylish looking. This is like the last one of the prior Bond films, Skyfall.
Yeah.
Shooting a silhouette against the
Macau
skyline.
I think you'll find that with Shanghai, but I'm not going to... Oh, I just did. Sorry.
Was it Shanghai?
I think it was Shanghai, yeah.
I don't know. I never saw it.
Highlander's back in the game.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny if she picked up a sword and she said, like, I'm a Highlander too.
We're all Highlanders. Again, look at this camera move. Look at that fucking cool camera move, guys. Isn't that good?
It's amazing.
Yeah.
It was all in the script as well.
It was all in the script. Now, I actually think Mulcahy says, in the script, it just says, McLeod gets the quickening. And it's like, and we just kind of had to figure it out from there. But this looks class.
It's a very good
music.
Yeah, came in score. Isn't it good?
Yeah.
If you're also... Are you going to listen to the... How are you listening to the music?
We've got a teeny... The volume's up a teeny little bit, so I can hear it.
I have it on full blast in my headphones, so I actually can't hear anything that you're saying.
Oh. I've got it now. Oh, shit, I could have done this the whole time.
Yeah.
You could have,
Then I couldn't have done my, like, stupid Sean Connery impression, so I guess it's like...
Look at that shot.
Yeah, that was the thing.
What's the line Connery says?
Well,
you're number one, McLeod.
Will, how long, how many times, how long did you spend practicing that stupid...
Years. Some would say I'm still doing it. Whenever I get any sort of... No, I don't.
Will does the podcast standing up, and whenever I look on the camera while we're recording, it's like the start of Die Hard 2.
this. Look at this. Look at this. Forget this it. Is a cool. No, I'm just seeing his Krogan's head being decapitated, and it looks class. And he's still swinging his sword.
It looks spectacular.
Best film ever. I'm going back to my shoes as whatever I was, an 11-year-old kid, and showing this to other 11-year-olds, and they were laughing at it, and I went, here we go, what a cool, oh god,
what kind of shitty 11-year-olds you hanging out with, Bill?
Yeah, like, they didn't get it. I was like going, what, this is fucking so class, and they
grew
just
up and they went to your college, Jamie.
It's the same kids. Yeah. Oh my god, it's the same kids.
Quite likely. It's like, god. I'm I don't know. Like, when I showed Hard Boiled, like, it's in my school, I was like, I don't know. They were like 16 or something. And I'm like, no, I don't know. It's like, what's with all the doves?
Oh my god!
The quickening overpowers me.
Doesn't it always?
especially if you've had a few drinks.
No, he's in an aha video. It seems like.
Do, 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 do. Oh, yeah. If only they'd done the soundtrack instead.
Yeah. Why? What's wrong with Queen's soundtrack? It's perfect. Oh, you can see the wires.
The wires,
oh,
yeah.
Oh, that no.
Is. You never would have seen the wires with aha doing the music.
Probably not. No. They had higher standards. Are we going to see the wires? Maybe. Not doing it.
So, Kevin, I'm guessing you haven't seen Highlander 2 or 3.
No.
Or the
no.
TVs. So how do you...
I've seen the start of the opening titles of the TV show.
Well, let me ask you...
used to come on and I'd always just turn over.
What? Okay, you've seen now Highlander. Highlander's cut off Kurgan's head. He's presumably, you know, there'll be only one. He is the only one. I'm going to ask you, pitch me. How do you do a Highlander sequel? Like,
you basically establish that the Highlanders are aliens. That's the only thing that can explain it. Science.
Wow.
This explains so much.
It does.
And how we, Kevin, we need to have Sean Connery back in the sequel. How, pitch me away getting Sean Connery back into the sequel.
Lots of money.
It's a kind of magic.
I'm actually kind of jazzed to watch the sequel now, actually, as a matter of fact.
Oh, man, the sequel. I watched it. Not that long ago. There it is. That was like probably 20 years ago. I'm thinking, but it was like, I could. It was very lush looking, but okay. Narratively, it is it's a mess. But it looks beautiful. It's got like so.
Have
many
you not just the, watched the first one?
Yeah, just
your standards are too high, lads.
I've watched so many of these. I've watched so much of the series. Well, not that so much. I watched a fair bit of the series. Too much, but I've watched three of the movies, and at least no, that's it. Three of the movies, and I think I turned on the television, and it was like one of the made for TV sequels was on. I was like, I don't think. And then I turned on there was the manga TV kiddie series, and it was like with Sean Connery. Someone doing a Sean Connery accent. I was like, my mind, I'm just going fucking mental here. I don't understand what the fuck is that. Yeah, too much Highlander.
So that was Highlander there, lads. This is me doing my Jamie ASMR voice as we wrap up the end of the episode. Well, Kevin, what did you think?
I thought it was fucking amazing.
Jamie. Was it good for you, Jamie?
What do you think, Jamie?
I drank a bottle of wine. I don't care.
Did not. There's no way you drank a whole bottle.
Did you really?
Good man. Did you really?
Good fucking
man. My God.
Yeah.
You hold it down well.
Thank you.
Apart from the time when you got up and you spent 20 minutes in the toilet. You've had to pause the recording.
Jimmy, you came back without your shirt on. Like, what's all that about? Jimmy came back just topless.
Sweating. Absolutely sweating. Jimmy, what are you doing in the toilet?
With some sort of paint all across your chest. and a tie across your forehead like you're a drunk uncle at a wedding
with a big ruler.
I had some business to attend to, lads. I'm not going to get into it here.
Oh my god.
Anyway, I enjoyed watching Highlander again.
Totally enjoyed
it. Only realizing the sound, I could have put the sound up until about like 2 minutes from the end.
This was our.
The nice thing is that the film will play over underneath us as we're talking, so people will be able to follow along a little bit better than you were able to.
You should experiment, seeing as this is our kind of like, you know, last audio commentary for a while. Have the film volume really high and our volume really low. See how that
only happens when we say something really wrong. Suddenly the film starts playing. Like, yeah. They've stopped talking. They've gone away for a while. It's really just because we've said something absolutely awful.
Yes, listeners. This is a behind-the-scenes expose here where, yeah, that's why. Yeah.
Okay, well, thanks, everybody, for joining us for the last episode of All the Best Bits. And we'll be back with something new.
This is the thing. Quite something soon. New. How exciting.
Something new.
Something new.
But thank you, everyone, for joining us over the last year on this epic journey through dozens of films, classic films. And thank you, Jamie, for joining us.
And Highlander.
And Highlander.
Yeah. Probably ended on the most classic of them all.
Absolutely. Yes.
Fuck Jaws.
Yeah. Right. Good luck.
Good night, everyone.
And here is a clip from the lad's latest Mini Bits bonus show. The full episode, plus 80 more, are available on their Patreon.
See ya, Mossy. I gotta go in and record another one of these fucking Mini Bits.
Oh, yes, it's such a little pity.
I know.
What are you doing?
I, right now, on the Academy screener site. And I hit play because there's only a few films on it for the first month or two. There's only like about less than 10 films on it. And Guy Ritchie's The Covenant is on here. So I hit play on that and I'm hearing all the, we're out in Afghanistan and I'm hearing all the dirt and I hear vehicles and I hear the sound effects of characters walking. But when characters open their mouths, I don't hear any dialogue.
Oh, they've
no dialogue.
They've uploaded the wrong audio track. It's like that Tom Cruise trailer where it was just the sound effects.
Like, have you met an SP?
Yeah, and this film has been up on the screener site for a few weeks now, and they still have the wrong one here. Well, I tell you what films are actually up there for all Academy members to see, and they see what they've put up.
But first of all, let's just throw to our theme. And I have to say, the feedback from my thank you ballad was quite fierce.
The power of Christ compels you!
So I asked Mossy, who is a friend of my dad's at the quiz, sing us a theme tune.
Oh.
So over to Mossy.
I can hit the cards. I'm fine, I'll get it done in one take. It's the Mini Bits. Or podcast, what will they say? With Will and Kevin Cock.
The best fucking podcast.
That'll do.
That'll do.
My God.
Thank you, Mossy.
You would make an angel weep. That voice would make an angel weep.
Telling you.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Boulibus.
It only cost us 2 months patron money, so, you know.
Is that all? Money well spent, in my eyes.
Yeah. I mean, you can't get much for €20. Will, you were telling me before the intro that you were looking at stuff on the Academy Screeners website.
The Academy Awards. So for official members, yes. So how they don't send out DVDs anymore. So how you do all your streaming stuff is all via the Academy website. And the streaming season has begun, which is exciting. So it means for the rest of the year...
Did it ever end?
It does end. It does after the Academy Awards. There's about 2 weeks and they take all the films down and then they begin again at the end of August and they all start coming up. So it's a whole new collection of hopefuls.
So how many films are on there?
Right now, about 10. Actually, 10 exactly. I can tell you the 10.
Oh, go on, tell me.
John Wick 4.
For the Oscars. Oh, because there's like...
Yes, they're adding in stunt category, aren't they?
Are they adding it in? It's a stunt category of United.
I believe they're adding in some sort of stunt category.
Breaking news straight from an Academy member's mouth.
Because they're adding in stunt category, aren't they?
Slash film.
I don't know. Did I see, read this in an article? I feel they were.
They...
I felt they were.
...have long overlooked stunts. And my God, it's pure artistry.
Yeah.
And it is... incredibly well these days. It's all fucking rubber computer generated avatars.
That's why we should highlight. That's why these people should be getting their Oscars when
backdated.
When someone's actually going out then. Yeah,
go back.
Absolutely.
Go back and give it to your man from Mad Max who broke his legs.
And give it to Richard Farnsworth, who was a stuntman and starred in The Straight Story. Yeah, Richard Farnsworth was a career stuntman. Oh. Absolutely.
Wasn't that also the case with Machete. What's your man, Machete? Danny Trejo.
Danny Trejo.
Is
really?
It Trejo or Trejo?
I always call him Trejo. He just says, call me Danny.
I was going to say that back to you.
Nah.
I was like, just
weird.
Just me. Just call him.